grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Tuesday, July 20th, so this Tuesday away, at 7 p.m. So all church council members are urged to attend. The Smiles is going to be on a hiatus for a bit, and they're going to be resuming, not this month, but in August, Pastor?
September.
So the September, the fourth Tuesday of the month on September, and this is also going to be via Zoom. The flowers today are given by Dottie to the glory of God in honor of Barbara Roskin's birthday and in memory of Gertrude and Jean Bobbitt. Thank you. Please join us for our 70th year celebration. That's going to be on Saturday, September the 25th. For our 70th year celebration, which is going to be a big, wonderful celebration that we're going to have. It is with sadness that we announce the death of Susan Holloway's sister, Ann Van Natta, passed away on Thursday, July 1st. Our prayers are with Susan and with her family during this difficult time. We take comfort in knowing that Lord has now welcomed Ann into the church. Triumphant. Let us celebrate her resurrections with all the saints, as Anne now shares eternal life with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. New members, please, if there's any new members, and I think I saw a couple of new faces out here today, which is wonderful. We're going to have a worship on Sunday, July the 25th, as St. Mark welcomes three of its new members. Our new members are Evelyn Geiser, what's her name? Christy Tremino, and Pablo Ferrer. So anyways, we welcome you all very much, and they come to us desiring membership in this church family. We welcome you into the Lord's family, and we joyously look forward to them sharing their gifts and presence with us in this community of faith. God, blessings to each one. And last but not least, we do have our happy birthdays are out to July, which is Crystal. Yay, Crystal. And while everybody's down on the bottom. So, Julia. So anyways, happy birthday, and we'll do our celebrations for July, okay? So, without much more ado, here's the passion.
All right, congregation, please stand for the confession and absolution found on page 3 of our Mass book. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires are known, from whom those secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, our God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, you ask of my hand, my mouth, and my eyes to serve. I've given only a small part of my life to you. Forgive me, renew me, and send me into the world with a changed heart. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained pastor of the Church of Jesus Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share God's peace with one another.
Thank you.
Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Give to us your servants that peace will your commandments. And also that we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may live in peace and quietness through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
A reading from Amos, the 7th chapter. This is what the Lord God showed me. The Lord was standing beside a wall built with a plumb line, with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a plumb line. Then the Lord said, see, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will never again pass them by. High places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste. And I will rise again, and I will rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, sent to King Jeroboam of Israel, saying, Amos has conspired against you in the very center of the house of Israel. The land is not able to bear all his words. For thus Amos had said, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel must go into exile and away from his land. And Amaziah said to Amos, O seer, go, flee away from the land of Judah. Earn your bread there and prophesy there, but never again prophesy at Bethel. For it is the king's sanctuary, and it is a temple of the kingdom. Then Amos answered Amaziah, I am no prophet, nor a prophet's son, but I am a head herdsman and a dresser of sycamore trees. And the Lord took me from following the flock, and the Lord said to me, give prophecy to my people Israel. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
second reading from Ephesians, the first chapter. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love, he destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will. To the praise of his glory and grace that he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time, to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Christ we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things according to his counsel and will, so that we, who were the first to set our hope on Christ, might live for the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you had heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance towards redemption as God's own people, to the praise of his glory. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Father God in heaven, we thank you for this day. And yes, we even thank you for this gospel that we read that sounds like something out of a horror picture film. But Lord, let us see your word in this and the gospel message that you have us to hear this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There's a story told of a preacher's five-year-old daughter who noticed that her father always paused and bowed his head for a moment before starting the sermons on Sunday morning. And one day, his daughter asked her father, "Why do you always pause and bow your head before giving your sermon?" And her father, proud that his daughter was actually so observant of his messages, replied, "Honey, I'm just asking the Lord to help me preach a good sermon." And the little girl said back to her father, "Well then, why doesn't the Lord ever answer your prayer?" There's another story told of little Johnny and his family who were having Sunday dinner at Grandma's house. And everyone was seated around the table as the food was being served. And when little Johnny received his plate of food, he started eating right away. And his mother protested, "Johnny, please wait until we say our prayer and ask God to bless our food." Little Johnny replied, "But Mommy, I don't need to." "Of course you do," his mother insisted. "We always say a prayer before eating at our house." And Johnny explained, "Mommy, that's at our house, but this is Grandma's house, and she knows how to cook." Well, given today's gospel lesson, I'm not sure a good sermon preached from the pulpit or prayer over dinner could make this sermon about martyrdom of John the Baptist any easier to preach. You see, today's gospel story is not a very uplifting story at all. In fact, it's a real downer. The good guys lose, and Mark depicts the loss in gruesome and horrible terms. The king not only has John the Baptist killed, but he passes his head around on a platter. And we know that things like this happen. But we would just as soon hear about something else when we come to church, right? We deal with enough unhappy things 6 days a week. And we would rather hear something much more encouraging on a Sunday morning. But this is a story in the Bible. And not only in the Bible, but for that matter, in the Gospels. Books that most churches, including the Lutheran Church, treat with special reverence. Because they tell us about the life of Jesus. And the story of John's death, in fact, is in all three synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And perhaps we need to take a moment to see if there is in this story a word from God for us today. When I first read this story, it seemed pretty grim. But when I did some serious digging, I realized that there is something more than the death of a martyr told in this story. This is also a story of hope, an encouraging story for difficult times. This is the story set inside another story. You see, Mark has been telling the story of Jesus sending out his 12 apostles on a mission, a very successful mission. All of these disciples have gone out healing and praying with people and healing disease and proclaiming the gospel. And then all of a sudden, Mark interrupts that story with this story about the death of John. And then he comes back to the story of the 12 apostles again, which he concludes with this verse, which is not printed in our lesson today. The apostles gathered around Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. And the apostles told Jesus what they had done. And what had they done? Well, just before telling us about John the Baptist, Mark told us the 12 disciples had called people to repent, had cast out many demons, and had anointed and cured many sick people. In other words, these apostles had been doing great, wonderful things in the name of God. Then all of a sudden, Mark interrupts that happy story to tell us this grim story of the death of John the Baptist. Well, for your information, this is not the only place where Mark inserts one story inside another. But be that as it may, why would he do it here? why would he start telling this big success story about the mission of the 12 apostles and then all of a sudden interrupt it with this terrible, horrible story of John's death? Why would he include all those gruesome details? Herod and his guests passing around John's head on a platter at a banquet? Really? Well, as nearly as we can tell, Mark did that as a way of saying to all of us and to his readers, look, terrible things happen in life. Nothing could be more terrible or gruesome than the story of John's death. But don't be fooled. That is not the whole story. Something important is going on in the background while John is being martyred, and that something important is God conquering evil. Disciples out there casting out demons. The disciples anointing and curing the sick. And Mark is saying to us, God is at work in the world. And we should never wonder who is going to win. The story of John's death set inside the story of the apostles' successful mission promises that God will win. Amen? Now, I'll be honest with you, this is a gospel that I know for a fact that most preachers, if not many, avoid preaching. I see a lot of even Lutheran pastors heading to the second lesson to preach on this day because that gospel is a pretty horrible thing to speak about. But I chose to speak on it today because I see the tragic events that have happened in our own lives of recent days. I think about COVID-19 and how many lives it has taken over the past year. I think about the most recent tragedy of the towers falling on the beach at Surfside. I think about the death of a president in Haiti this very past week. I even think of the tragic death of Mao's son-in-law, who was killed in a hit-and-run accident. And I'm reminded that God never promised that in this life. Yes, the kingdom begins now, but this is not the kingdom fulfilled in this earth. Tragedy and bad things happen. But just like the apostles were continuing to preach and teach and heal and pray with people when those bad things happened, like John the Baptist, look at how God continued to be at work during COVID. Think how God continued to use first responders and doctors and medical staff to save people's lives, sometimes to the point that they lost their own life. Think about how the people have responded with love from all over the world, given the tragedy that happened on the beach. Think how America and other countries have responded to Haiti, bringing the wife of the president here and offering support. Think about how many of you showed love and support as you attended the graveside memorial for Mao's son-in-law, Stephanie's husband, this past week. Those are all acts of God continuing to do his work in spite of what tragedies and devastations take place. And I'm not suggesting that this makes it easy. When Mark is perhaps reminding us that bad things happen, even to good people, and the bad things that happen to us, be assured that is not God's punishment for our sins. God's will is not being done in those bad things. John the Baptist wasn't doing anything wrong when they killed him. In fact, he was doing something right. He was telling Herod, hey, you should not be marrying your brother's wife. That's wrong. And that upset Herod a little bit, but it upset his wife Herodias a whole lot more. And obviously she wanted to have John killed for saying that to her husband. But then one night Herodias, the daughter, gets a chance to do this dancing. Her daughter did a dance that pleased Herod on his birthday, and I don't even want to think about what kind of dance that might have been. Any other father would have put a stop to that immediately, but not Herod. He had a choice to make. He told the girl that she was wonderful and offered her anything that she wanted up to the half of his kingdom. And so the girl did what most young girls do when faced with a big decision. She went to her mother and asked for advice, and she asked her mother, "What should I ask Herod for?" And the answer was easy as far as mom was concerned. Her mother wanted John's head. And so not only did her daughter ask for John's head, she asked for John's head on a platter. Even Herod was horrified at the idea, but he was trapped, he felt. All the important people in the kingdom were at his banquet, his birthday. They heard his offer and heard the daughter's request. And Herod found himself between the devil, literally, and the deep blue sea. He didn't want to kill John, but he also did not want to embarrass himself in front of his friends. And so, yes, he did kill John, just as he and Pilate would later kill Jesus. But in the background, the apostles were still out there doing good things on their mission, preaching and calling people to repentance, casting out demons and healing the sick. God was not absent, and evil was not winning the race. And yes, one good man was being murdered, but hundreds of others were being saved. Mark's church needed to hear that. By the time that he wrote this gospel, the church was already suffering terrible persecution, and Christians were being put in prison, even killed. Not because they had done anything wrong, but because they were doing something right. And I believe Mark wrote this story within the story to reassure them. Yes, bad things happen, but they should never doubt good things were happening too, and God is always at work in the world, and everything would come out all right in the end. And sisters and brothers, we need to hear that in this day, among all the devastation and tragedies that take place in our life. There are always people out there who are doing bad things, people trying to undo you and bring you down, or personal tragedies or whatnot. In life, it's difficult. It was difficult in Mark's day. And those tragedies from without happen continuously in this day. But these threats are not just frightening from without, they are things that happen within. For instance, when faced with danger or pain or loneliness or depression, so many things, it's difficult to believe that there is anything right in the world around us. But the story of John's martyrdom is set inside the story of a successful mission of the apostles. It tells us God continues to be at work. Amen?
Amen.
God will win. And the story reassures us that if we walk with God, in the long run, all will be well. And that is an important promise to remember when we are in danger. I was so grateful at the graveside this past week to see hundreds of people attending this memorial, and people I did not even know. And after speaking words of resurrection and redemption, people came up to me and said, "Father, I believe in God, and I believe in eternal life, and I believe there is life after death." God is still at work. God's grace is sufficient. Amen?
Amen.
A few years ago, in that little devotional guide that some of you read, The Upper Room, Susan Strack wrote a story about a broken sand dollar. You've probably seen a sand dollar, those lovely little seashells. And Susan had brought a sand dollar while vacationing at the ocean one summer, and sometime later one of her children bumped into a piece of furniture and the sand dollar fell to the floor and shattered it into pieces. And Susan and her son gathered up the little pieces together and took them to the kitchen, and they tried gluing them back together again. And in her article in the devotional, Susan writes, "As we glued the parts together and noticed an intricate structure within, it occurred to me that each one of us are a little like that sand dollar. When our spirits are broken, God helps us discover inner resources that we never have known existed within us, or that we have, and he puts us back together again." I think that is one of the things that St. Mark is trying to tell us in the story of John the Baptist's death, set aside the larger stories of the apostles' successful missionary events. He's telling us that if we walk in faith, God will transform our Gethsemanes into holy gardens where we and others can come to find strength and grow in faith. He's telling us not to lose hope even in the midst of the most terrible circumstances in which we find ourselves in life, because God is still at work and God will prevail. He is telling us that when our spirits are broken, God puts us back together again, just like the sand dollar. And I'm sure each one of us gathered here at St. Mark's this morning, we each have a story of sorrow or challenge that we could talk about. A story that has been so challenging for us to live through. But sisters and brothers, don't lose sight of your story and God's bigger story. And his bigger story is for your life that goes beyond this life. God is still at work in your life here and in the life to come. And God's will prevail. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And God is standing by you to put back together again all the broken pieces of your life and my life, today, now, and forevermore. And as God's people together, we say, Amen. Amen. Congregation, please rise. And may the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus our Lord. Pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, for all people, for their needs. Let us be seated and let us pray. Father God in heaven, we witness each day in our world, in our country, in our individual lives, tragedy and maladies and horrific things. Maybe some even as great as what we read in today's gospel. Horrifying things that take place in our world. But Lord God, our story is just a story in the larger picture of your creation story for us, your redeeming story for our lives. Lord God, let us understand that you never promised that things would be perfect in this earth, that bad things will happen, but as long as we walk beside you and continue to grow in our faith, you will give us strength that we did not even know that we had to focus on your spirit in our lives, to lift us up like eagle's wings and bring us through the day. Lord God, let us hear the word that is spoken to us this day, that you are always at work in our world, in our life, in everything about us. Let us continue to build that kingdom of God and know that your spirit and your love is always with us. Lord, in your mercy.
Pray for Stephanie Delgado, Robin Moore, Sharon Argus, Betty Rover, Dolly Teasdale, Danny Pacheco, Werner Barr, Maria Morgan, Jennifer Rago, Louise G. Helmuth Wagner, Rose Martinez, Steve Raisin, Blanca Carose, Jorge Resorta, Leanne Mendez, Ismael Gonzalez, Zunil Nabero, Otamar Magarson, Denise Cook, Brad Cook, Karen Joyce, and Linda Ford, Odinia Beasley and family, Philippe Picard, Diane Tamargo, Dr. Thomas Johnson and family, Monica Dawes, Sheila Hoff, Danette Perez, Marta Serra, Angelus Peace, Tim Kelly.
Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, we offer a special petition of prayer for which the candle is lit today for the president of Haiti, the loss of his life, and we pray for his dear wife and family and the entire country during this difficult time of grieving and sorrow. May they find their resurrection and their faith in you as we continue to stand by them in prayer and love. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, this day we also offer a special petition for all those who are traveling this summer. We pray for researchers and scientists who have developed a COVID-19 vaccine and continue to try to confront the new variant that's out there and protect people, Lord, from this dreadful disease. And continue to give healing to those who continue to be impacted with suffering and sorrow for its results in so many people. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, most of all, we pray for thanksgiving for all the blessings you continue to give each one of us. We pray for the ministries of this congregation. We pray for each person that is here this morning. We pray, Lord, for our visitors, David and Brenda, and all those who come, and all those who could not be here this day. Keep each one safe. Lord, by continue to bless faithful pastors and the bishop of our church. In your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray. Trust in your mercy for your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
This time, let's receive our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings.
Thank you.
Merciful Father, risen one, as you broke bread with the disciples on the shore, feed us now and in this new.
Nourish us to follow you,
using our gifts
to heal the hungry and tender to your weary,
and all for your love's sake.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It's indeed right and our duty and our joy that we should at all times and all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God. Through our Savior Jesus Christ, fulfilling the promise of the resurrection, you pour out the fire of your Spirit, uniting in one body people of every nation and tongue. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Christ has died. Christ has risen.
Christ will come again.
Through him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
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 Gathered into one by God's Holy Spirit, let us pray the prayer that our Lord Jesus taught us to pray together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, gives everyone a place at the welcome table. Please come forward to receive the body.